Hello, welcome to Motorcycle News and welcome to the inside of my garage, which unfortunately is about as far as my bike is going to be going anytime soon. For as long as there's a ban on all non-essential travel, I guess there must be thousands, if not millions, of bikes up and down the country all facing a similar predicament, all being quarantined away into short-term storage. Although that's not something that my SV650S is too unfamiliar with. I bought this back in 2003 when I was 21 years old, and over the past 17 years I've ridden it less than 10,000 miles. So this bike has spent far more than its fair share of time lurking in the corner of damp sheds or being hidden away under a cover in a garage somewhere. Although that said, it still does get regularly resurrected every year for a summer blast, so I always keep it in ready-to-ride condition. And hopefully, having had 2 decades of trial and error, plenty of error, when it comes to putting bikes into and taking them out of storage, hopefully I've learned a thing or two. So I thought I'd put together a quick 5 quick and easy tips that will help you ensure your bike is ready to ride the second the lockdown lifts. The first thing you have to think about is the petrol that's in your bike's tank. When it's left exposed to the atmosphere for a couple of months, petrol goes stale, and there are 3 things that happen to it. The first is evaporation. That's where the shorter, more volatile chemicals within the fuel simply vanish off into thin air, leaving behind just the kind of the heavier hydrocarbons. The second is oxidization. That's where the fuel literally reacts with the oxygen in the air and forms this kind of gunky sludge that can block up your carburetor or your fuel injector. And the third is contamination. That's when water gets into the fuel, perhaps from condensation or water vapour, and is drawn in by the ethanol that's in petrol nowadays. Fancy folks call this phase separation, and what happens is the ethanol and the water kind of sinks to the bottom of your fuel tank, where it inevitably gets drawn up and thrown into your combustion chamber, and terrible things happen. So there's a couple of schools of thoughts about how you best deal with it. The first and perhaps most obvious is simply to drain all the fuel out of your bike. That means emptying the tank completely, taking it off, getting every last bit out of the fuel pump, out of any carb float bowls, running the bike till it stops because it literally has no fuel left in the system anywhere. And that's a pretty good idea if you've got the time and the inclination. There is a school of thought that suggests that a fuel tank left empty is perhaps more prone to rusting because the condensation that can form inside it. Absolutely the worst thing you can do is to leave your fuel tank just half full, because that guarantees that you've got a steady flow of fresh air, fresh oxygen and fresh water vapour in through the overflow or through the breather pipe, and that guarantees that your fuel is going to go off as soon as it possibly can. My preferred way of dealing with it is to use a fuel stabiliser, something like this is Putalene's fuel stabiliser. I haven't got any particular reason to vouch for it. It's just something that I've been using for a few years and has always done pretty well for me. The great thing about fuel stabilizer is it's incredibly simple to use. You simply need to work out how much you need to put in your bike's tank. This one's nice and easy because it's a one shot that is enough to treat 20 litres of petrol. You pour it into your bike's tank. Make sure to top it up with a load of fresh unleaded. Shake the bike back and forth to distribute the stabiliser amongst all the fuel, and then the key thing that some people forget to do is to then run the bike for a good kind of 5 minutes on idle to let the stabilised fuel run all the way through the fuel system. So that means it's coating the inside of the carbs or the fuel injectors, and to ensure that there is no unstabilised fuel sat left lingering in your bike for months at a time. The second thing to think about is your tyres. Now, some folk will tell you to overinflate them because that reduces the contact patch that the bike is sitting on. Others will tell you to drop the pressures because that somehow reduces the internal load. I think both of them are a bit needless, really. I would just ensure that your tyres are pumped up to the correct manufacturer specified pressure levels. And the other advantage of that, apart from it being a lot easier, you don't need any extra brain power, is that when you come to get your bike out of storage, you can put a gauge on them, and at an immediate glance, you'll know whether they've lost any pressure in storage, which might give you a little hint that there's a bit of a slow puncture or a bit of a leak somewhere. Now, the key to getting your tyre pressure spot on is to use a decent gauge. And I've used a few over the years. I'm a bit of a nerd when it comes to it. The two that I come back to time and time again are this It was a Hafner. It's now rebranded as a Venhill VT32. It's about 20 quid. It's a nice dial gauge with a nice chunky rubberized body, a little bleed valve, and a gorgeous braided hose. The other is this, an Oxford DigiGauge. It's smaller, but it's battery powered. There's a little light. It's a bit of a nerd's fest, really. It's 25 quid, so it's a bit more expensive. But I know these are both very accurate. They're both really easy to use. So just make sure your tyres are pumped up to the exact level they should be and leave them there. Once you've got your pressure spot on, the other thing you can do that will really help your tyres keep their shape and still be in good nick come a couple of weeks' time is to get the bike up on some paddock stands. Now, there's some really lovely, beautifully built Harris paddock stands and £100 things out there. But the truth is, it just needs to be something that gets the wheels off the floor. I've got an old Motrax paddock stand I use at the back, which can't have cost me more than 30 or 40 quid. And at the front, I've got an Oxford big black bike stand, which I think is 50 quid nowadays. Obviously, when it comes to getting your bike up on the stands, simply roll the bike into position, keep it balanced, slot the rear in first, get the bike up and balanced on that. And then, when everything's right, come round to the front and get the front in second. So long as your wheels are off the floor, that's all you really need to do. Next up is your battery. Now, all batteries will start to lose some amount of charge over time. If yours is in good nick, it should probably be fine for a few weeks or maybe even a month or two. But if you have an alarm fitted or a tracker, or if it's not in that great health to begin with, it could really be struggling if we're in lockdown for a little while. For my money, given how affordable smart chargers are these days and given the cost of replacement batteries, it's not really a risk worth taking. There are all sorts of different clever chargers you can buy. You can pay an absolute fortune for some of them. The best value one, I think, at the moment is an Optimate One Duo. I think it's one of the most affordable in their range. It's about 40 quid, and it doesn't look much. It's a little box, but it's super adaptable. You can use it on any type of battery, from lead acid to gel to even fancy lithium polymer jobbies. It comes with crocodile clips or a harness you can wire into the battery. And it's so easy to use. You just plug it in and the charger takes care of everything else. It tops it up, it does a voltage retention test, which where every 30 minutes it doesn't put any charge in, and then it measures how your battery's voltage declines over time. And if it thinks there's a problem, it puts more charge back in. And if it thinks there's a really big problem, it will tell you that your bike isn't holding charge, in which case go and get a new battery, because you'll need it for this summer anyway. You can buy faster chargers, you can buy smarter chargers, you can buy those that plug directly into the CAN bus socket or the 12 volt socket on a CAN bus BMW. You can buy battery chargers that will recover and desulfate from even lower voltage than this one. But if you think you've got a fairly healthy battery and you're just looking for something to tide you over for potentially a couple of weeks or even a couple of months, I think this really is all you need. If you park your bike somewhere where you don't have access to a wall socket, then you kind of have two options, really. There are some solar panel powered battery chargers available. I haven't got any personal experience of them, but I'm told they work well. Or the simpler option is to take your bike's battery out and bring it into the house with you, keep it on charge with one of these, and then it's all ready to go whenever we get the thumbs up. Now, your bike is going to be in storage for a few weeks at least, and if you're garage is anything like mine, it's perhaps a bit damp and drafty, and unfortunately they're the perfect conditions for rust and corrosion to set in. So before you lay it up, it's probably a good idea to treat all the vulnerable metal parts with some kind of anti-corrosion agent. Now, I'd say the top two on the market right now are XCP's Rust Blocker and ACF50. They're fantastic at keeping rust away, but they are slightly involved if you want to apply them correctly. You really need just a thin coat, so you either want to apply them with a paint gun and a compressor, or to kind of meticulously go around with a cloth, wiping the surfaces down afterwards so there's no sticky build-up. If you're happy to do that, then that's great, but if you're like me and a little bit lazy, then I think something like Scott Oiler's FS365 is a far more convenient solution. A lot of winter riders aren't so keen on this stuff because it's water soluble, so you need to reapply it every time you go for a wet ride or after every wash. But for what we're looking for something you can squirt on once now and then leave on the bike in the garage for a few weeks or months, I think this is really convenient, really handy stuff, and this is what I'd use. If you can't get hold of or don't want to shell out for some specific anti-corrosion agent, then obviously a good squirt round with some WD-40 will do the trick, or any kind of generic water dispersal agent. But whatever you put on is better than putting nothing on. One other thing that's definitely worth doing before you put your bike away is to give the chain a quick spray with some lube, just to help protect it again from any rust or corrosion over the coming weeks. There's all sorts of products out on the market. There's plenty of choice. For what it's worth, my two favourites, the two I have most faith in at the moment, are XCP's chain lubricant and S100 White Chain Spray 2.0. Don't really know why. I just think if you're after a bit of a nod in one direction, that you won't go wrong if you use either of those. With all that done, the last step is to protect your bike by putting a cover over the top of it. Now, obviously, if your bike's been stored outside, it needs to be quite heavy duty and waterproof. But if it's staying in a garage like mine is, then it needs to be a different type of cover. An indoor cover should be thinner, and most crucially, it should be breathable. And the reason for that is that if a cover's too tight-fitting, too snug around a bike, and doesn't allow air to pass, then you end up with this kind of pocket of air between the bike and the cover, which, as the temperature in the garage rises and falls throughout the day and the night, that is a perfect opportunity for condensation to form. And then you end up with moisture sitting over the top of the bike, and that's how bikes go rusty while they sit in storage. So the cover that I use is an Oxford Dormex indoor bike cover. It's a Ride magazine best buy, and it does everything an indoor bike cover should. It's lightweight, it's breathable, there's a soft liner, and it's elasticated around the bottom to keep it tight. It's not even that expensive. This is starts at about £20 for the small size and goes up to £35 for the extra large. A medium is all I need for the SV, and that is just £25. So that's a worthwhile investment. One final thing is just to make sure that there's enough slack in the battery charging cable so that when you pull the cover down over the top of it, it doesn't pull the thing out the wall or the lead out the side of the bike. If you've done everything so far, then your bike is about as ready as it can be. Nothing's too expensive or too technically difficult. It's just a little bit of extra prep now is well worth the investment so that the second lockdown is over, we can all make the most and get straight out on the road.